Welcome to The Economics of Everything. I'm Tim Harcourt, the Airport Economist from the UNSW Business School. Today we have a very special guest, Dr. Andrew Leigh. He is a politician, the Shadow Assistant Treasurer and the Member for Fraser. He's also a former Professor of Economics. He's just released a fantastic new book, The Economics of Almost Everything. It talks about everything from sport, love, art, even how you find romance. So you're really, I think, going to enjoy this interview at the University of New South Wales Business School. Welcome to The Economics of Everything.
Thank you very much, Tim. Good to be here.
Great to have you. Congratulations on your book.
Thanks.
Let's start with love. I spoke to Gigi Foster, an academic here, a good friend of yours, and we talked about the economics of love and romance. Now, your wife's American. You persuaded her to come from America to live with you in Australia, and you've got three lovely boys. Did you use economics to chat up Gwen and get her to come out here, or did you use other powers of persuasion?
Yeah, so that is one of the things about the economics of love, Tim, which is important to be clear about. I do think about dating, for example, as being what economists call an optimal stopping problem. We have various of these optimal stopping problems, of course. If you're selling your house, then there's an array of offers that are coming in, and there's a point at which you want to accept one of those offers and sell the house rather than leave it on the market forever. If you're looking for a job, then every time you go for a job interview, you learn a little bit more about the firm, but in the end you probably want to settle down and choose a job. And an economist think of marriage in much the same way. But much as there might be 50 ways to leave your lover, I think there's only one way to use the economics of love, and that's carefully and tactfully. So I didn't talk very much economics with Gwyneth on our first few dates. We talked about art and culture, and I hid my economics under a bushel.
Very, very wise. interestingly, about your book is about the rise of stars or sports billionaires. And you wrote in the chapter about efficiency in the AFL, how we measure the best cricketer. How did you come about, I mean, all Aussies love sport. How did you come about that framework, cricket and footy, for instance?
Well, I'd always been interested in applying the tools of economics to sport. In the case of cricket, I used some terrific work by Nicholas Rode to determine the best batsman in the world. And we can't simply take the highest average. Otherwise, if we did that, we'd have West Indian Andy Gunaratna, who has an average of 112. One innings, got 112.
It was a good 112.
It was a terrific 112, but that's his only innings.
Fantastic.
And I don't think most cricket tragics, even West Indians, would rank him above Bradman. So Rode has a lovely way of thinking about the opportunity cost of including a new batsman in the team and penalising batsmen who are scoring below the average batsman who might otherwise go into the team. And so he weights that against the average to come up with an all-time cricket great list. And the other exercise I do in the economics of just about everything is to look at AFL sporting teams' productivity. I take the amount that they spend on not only their player salaries but also expenses like coaches and masseuses, and then look at whether more money buys you more wins on the field. Turns out it does. Spend another $1 million, win another game. But then there's teams that are particularly productive. So Geelong is the most productive team in the AFL, winning many more games than its team spending would lead you to expect. And conversely, Fremantle's off the other end of the spectrum, winning fewer games than its spending would lead you to predict.
Now, just to show that we're Renaissance guys, we're not all sport. We talk about art, and in the economics of almost anything, you talk an interesting chapter about conceptualists versus experimentalists. Now, as I understand it, there are people, Mozart, Van Gogh, or Picasso, who conceptualise things very young and peak early, and then there's people like the great Emily from Utopia, the Aboriginal artist, who through their life experience come to their brilliance. That was an interesting chapter to show your cultural side.
Well, it's also not just about thinking about art, Tim, but about our own careers. And so David Gallinson from the University of Chicago has noticed two types of creative people. One type that are driven by theories and grand ideas where they look inwards for their inspiration. Picasso is very much like this. And Picasso's work in his 20s is much more valuable than the work that he does in his 60s. Then there's another set of artists who draw on the world around them, on experience. Think of Dickens, Shakespeare, Matisse. And those people tend to do their best work later in life. And so I took that to the Australian data, went through the various art anthologies to come up with a list of great Australian artists, and then looked at when they peaked. And you see similarly a set of the Heidelberg School, people like Robertson, Streeton, who are doing work in their 20s, which is driven by ideas and is very, very quick. They do outdoor landscapes, sometimes dash them out in 15 minutes.
He's not been paid by the hour, clearly.
Indeed. But then their work later on in life doesn't tend to get better. In fact, sometimes it sells for lower prices at auction. And then there's people like Arthur Boyd, who's very much driven by his travels through the landscape and who's commissioned to do the tapestry for the Great Hall and Parliament House when he's in his 60s. So thinking about whether you're a conceptualist driven by one big idea or an experimentalist infused by what's around you is, I think, useful for all of us in our own lives.
There was a very good chapter in your book about Australia's aid program, whether we should be looking at our comparative advantage, moving from the mining boom to the dining boom. You say a little bit about how we should run our aid program that I found interesting.
Well, an aid program, I think, ought to be targeted at comparative advantage. And comparative advantage for economists is thinking about what we do better than other countries in a comparative sense. So for Australia, you've mentioned the mining boom there, Tim. I think with lots of developing countries around the world having copious natural resources, Australia has a really powerful role to play in helping them better use those resources. Not just the transparency of fiscal flows, but actually making sure that there's good geological maps out there and that mining rights are sold by auction, which is economists' notion of the best way of getting the true price for something. So I think rather than trying to just copy what all other developed countries are doing in our aid program, yes, we want to look to our region, but also we want to look to strengths like dry land farming, fragile states and skills in mining.
A good example of that is, in Mongolia, they have good deposits, but the Soviet system of management made it very hard. Mm. So a lot of Mongolians, the Mongolian Australian Association, the Mozzies, a lot of them are, of course, educated in Australia. So a lot of the soft skills matter as well in the aid program, as well as the actual hard skills and the deposits and so on.
Absolutely. Mongolia is a great example there where you want to fight the resource curse. The problem, of course, for developing countries has been that those with more natural resources tend to be poorer, not richer. And that's because diamonds are a dictator's best friend. It's hard to expropriate human capital. It's hard to force people to be entrepreneurial. But it turns out to be pretty easy to rip a whole lot of precious stones out of the ground and give them to your mates. So the benefits of mining wealth haven't flowed through a population in many developing countries in the way in which Australia's done a better job of it. So we've got stuff to teach those countries, though of course our settings aren't perfect either.
My last question, Andrew, goes a little bit to you because we talked about your career as a rights lawyer involved in human rights and government and public policy. You had a very successful career as an economist at Harvard, at the Kennedy School and at the ANU. And then you're, of course, the member for Fraser. And I was very pleased that you won the pre-selection because you ran the gamut of the factions. And we now have in Parliament an intellectual fellow like yourself, a bloke that when you're a numbers man, you do the numbers on a spreadsheet, not in a Chinese restaurant. Did you apply game theory or economic theory to your pre-selection? Because it was quite a win.
I applied nothing really, Tim, but single-minded focus to meet as many people as possible. And one of the striking things coming from the lecture halls into the Parliament is the power of stories. I think economists tend to underplay the value of stories because we're so excited by statistics. But ultimately, the marriage of the two is a perfect match. And so when I was in my pre-selection, I very much wanted to tell stories about the kind of Labor Party that I wanted to see and the kind of Australia that I wanted to be a part of building. And in the economics of just about everything, I've done my best also to leave in the statistics with plenty of stories throughout.
Fantastic. Well, we've got the undercover economist, the airport economist for economics, and now we've got the economics of almost everything. So congratulations, Andrew, and good luck with the book and everything else you do in Parliament.
Thank you, Tim, and I'm looking forward to reading yours when it comes out later this year.